Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua, Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
So would you guys turn to Romans 8? And I'm so excited because this is the chapter that if I could pick one chapter to make into mini sermons, like mini devotionals for people to hear about the Lord, this would be the chapter that has the most richest life-transforming truths in just like little paragraph form. Like just if you are going to make a devotional, say you just someone of those people wants like a daily devotional, you can take the Romans 8 and just read a couple verses of it, and that's one devotional, and then go to the next couple verses, and just basically, not even paragraph by paragraph, just some of them, just a couple verses, makes a devotional all on its own. Like verse 1 says, there is therefore, now how much condemnation for us that are in Christ? None. You can have a whole devotional about, there's no condemnation for us that are in Christ Jesus. None. Absolutely none. And we've been going over, Paul's talking about last week in chapter 7, how the very thing he wanted to do, he didn't do, right? And the things he knew he should do, wait, the things, it's doo-doo chapter again. It's a, you know what I mean. It's that part within us that wants to do right, but then we don't do it. And the very thing we don't want to do, we do do. And that's the doo-doo part of the chapter, that we just, it's part of the way we're wired, and we went over how Paul said last week, oh wretched man that I am, he says, who's going to set me free from this body of sin and death? He said, I found within my body, there is this fleshly urges, desires, that try to rule my life, and he goes, on my mind, on the one hand, I try to serve God with my mind, but on the other hand, I've got these fleshly impulses, and he says, I feel like I'm conflicted. One side is trying to do good, and the other part of me is trying to do evil. And he said, and because of this, when he read the law, he said, I discovered that because of the law, sin was present within me. Because as soon as the law said, don't do something, don't walk on the grass, we went over last week, don't covet. What did Paul say? Produced in him every kind of covet. As soon as you're told, don't do something, why do we go do it? You know, since we, so Paul says, I figured this out. I have sin in me, but I have this, how do I deal with it? And first thing you have to learn to deal with is what he said in verse 1 of chapter 8. There's no condemnation for you because you find out that you have sin present within you. There's none. You know why? Because the condemnation was paid for, the condemnation for our sin. Yes, that we deserve to have to pay a payment penalty for our sin. Except who paid the penalty? Jesus. That's right. It says, there is no condemnation for us who are in Christ Jesus. Why? Because he paid for all of our sins. And it says, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, this is verse 2, has set us free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh as an offering for sin. And then he condemned sin in the flesh. See, when Christ came, I don't know if you know this, but Jesus took on himself all of our sins on his shoulders. He paid. He took it all on himself and said, okay, give me the punishment. I'll take it. I'll pay for everybody's sin. And when he did that, God said, okay, I condemn sin in the flesh. That's why, by the way, you ever wonder, why did God have to send Jesus? Now, why did he have to send his son to this world? Because the requirement of the law was, somebody has to pay for the sin. The only problem is that you have to be a perfect, unblemished lamb, according to the Old Testament law, to be a perfect, appropriate sacrifice to take away sin. And that's why it's so important when we read in the Bible about John the Baptist being the Lamb of God. Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. It's really important to our faith that we share that with you. We don't pay for our sins. Jesus did. I don't have to worry about paying. He paid it in full. But I want to put my faith on what he did. Because when I do, it's covered. And it says in verse 4, so the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us. It says, who do not walk now according to the flesh, but now we walk according to what? This is where we pick up today. According to the Spirit. I just recap for you so we can continue today. Picking up in verse 5 now. For those who are according to the flesh, set their minds on the things of what? The flesh. And these it says, but those that are according to the Spirit, they set their minds on what? The Spirit. It says, for the mindset on the flesh is death, but the mindset on the Spirit is life and its peace. See, when we put our mind on the flesh, on our fleshly urges and desires, I just want to take care of me. I'm hungry. I gotta feed myself. You know, I don't know about how your house is, but sometimes when you put me and Daniel in the same room in the early morning, we're both hungry. Two males in the kitchen trying to get to the food first, you know.
Is that Romans?
This is Romans chapter 8. When you put the two of us in the room, it's probably not good if we're both hungry and we're both attending to the needs of our flesh. Let's just be honest. When we're talking about feeding ourselves, we're talking about not physical or spiritual food. We're talking about physical food. I want to feed this body. And sometimes the flesh can be not so nice. And not so peaceful either. It's weird how when we put our mind on the things of the flesh, we can become rude to others, cranky with others, short with others. Get out of my way. I'm using the microwave now. Get out of my way. You know, I'm first, you know, or what? That the flesh is always about me, satisfying me first. But the problem with that is it brings death, not life. When my mind is set on, it all comes down to, what is your mind set on? I could do a devotional on, what is your mind set on? Is your mind set on things of the Spirit? Or is your mindset on the flesh? Because, by the way, this is the part we get to control. Is what part, what do we put our mind on? You guys do know that you have that, as God granted us the free will to choose what we think on. He doesn't make us think on Him. He doesn't make us think about spiritual things. He says, that's up to you. But you're granted this power, this freedom, to choose what you think on. Now, if you spend all your time thinking about satisfying your flesh, there's a problem. Whatever you put your mind on, well, there's different outcomes. Your mind's on the flesh, it brings death. It can bring death to your relationships. Maybe you're just a jerk in the kitchen in the morning, you push everyone out of the way, and they're like, I don't want to even around me anymore. Why don't you go live somewhere else? Or, you know, I mean, how many people do you think have gotten divorced over low blood sugar? I mean, seriously, I'm just pointing out this as a pastor because we get calls. This is a crisis. You know, it's gone nuclear. And you're like, have you eaten? My Nona would have scolded him because, have you eaten yet? Have you, you know, she would have said, have you had something, some water? You know, you're getting a little, you know, when you do get dehydrated, how you get foggy brain? You get all, like, goofy, can't think straight, and you get a little cranky. And she would be like, before we're going to talk about this, have you eaten? Have you had something to drink? You know, take care of these basic things. Let's get you where you're able to use this mental gift that God's given you clearly. And now, what are you going to set your mind on? Things of the Spirit or things of the flesh? Now, because it says in verse 7, because the mindset on the flesh is hostile towards God, for it doesn't even subject itself to the law of God, and it's not even able to do so. And those who are in the flesh, it says, cannot please God. This is one of the things when I read, I was like, man, I don't know about you, but I want to please God. I want Him to be pleased with me. I like the verse what says that the eyes of the Lord in Chronicles, they move to and fro about the whole earth, looking for someone, just one person, whose heart is completely the Lord's. And you know why it says He does that? To find that person whose heart is toward Him, that He might strongly support that person. Now, I know, like Dylan wants God to strongly support him, getting ready to go on outreach and travel around the world. By the way, we're going to pray over him at the end of the service today, because he's heading out to to the Syrian refugee camp, is that what it is? And then where else?
I'm going to Greece and Jordan.
To Greece and Jordan. So we'll be praying for him and his outreach team from YWAM. And, but if you want God's strong support in your life, God looks at the heart. Not how you dress, not how on the outside. He's looking inside. How is your heart toward him? And if your heart is completely just, Lord, my heart wants to serve you. I want to go after you. Then these words are for you today. You want to have a mind that is set on the Spirit. Because you get to choose this. You get to choose what you put your mind on. Now, I grew up in northern Arizona for a season in my high school days. And my best friend in high school, mom and dad were Mexican and Yavapai Indian. One was from the, there's an Indian reservation right by where we lived. And so his dad was from the Indian reservation and his mom was Mexican down. This was my best friend. So his heritage was both. You know, he was taught both cultures. They had the tortilla factory in northern Arizona and people just loved their homemade tortilla. And I always got the, you put them through, you stretch them and then they get stretched one way, you turn them halfway and then send them back through the little stretcher and it kind of rounds them out. But if they don't go through just right, they sometimes come out funky, like shaped like a pear. But it's still a good tortilla. It's just not good for the packing. So those were called seconds. And since I was a good friend of his, I could get all the seconds that I wanted when I'd go over to the house and walk in the back door and say, Ma, could I get some tortillas, you know? And the whole pile of seconds would be there. I could take as much as I want, you know? And so I grew up with them, and there was the influence of his dad. His dad, being an Indian, taught him some of the Indians have their own way of explaining truths. A lot of it is using things in nature. You know, they're very, they use a lot of animal examples, you know, in explaining, like when the father's trying to teach truths to his son. And it was interesting to me because I was coming to learn about the Lord. At the same time, his dad was teaching him this thing that the Indian teaching, that he said, within a son, there's a white dog and a black dog. And he said, and the white is the good part, you know, and the black is the evil part. And these two are always poising and getting ready for a dog fight. It's going to be which one, and then he said, and you want to know, if you want to make sure that the white dog always wins in the fight, what do you have to do? And he would tell, this is how he would teach his son this truth. Now, it's really interesting because I'm reading Romans, and he's telling us this Indian story about a white dog and black dog that lives within every person. This is the Indian culture teaching this idea of good and evil. So he says, when the two, daily, he says, they square off to fight for control of the, kind of like control of the ring kind of thing, he would say. But the ring was us. We're the ring. Inside us is the two dogs. And which one's going to rule? He says, well, it's easy. He said, which one do you feed? The one you feed the most and you train the most. Like, if you feed the white dog all the time, you feed the good part of your life, you feed your spirit all the time, and yes, we have a war that, you guys know that feeling. Does anyone besides me understand the struggle between feeling the flesh wanting attention and the spirit wanting attention? You're like, but which one have you been feeding? How about you feed only the white dog all day long, you feed it, you train it, you keep it all healthy, and you starve the black dog. I mean, it has no food. It starts to get weak and scrawny. And the fight comes time to fight. And the black dog is just, it's so weak it can't fight. This is what he was trying to teach his son. If you feed the good side all the time, then every time the battle happens, and by the way, how often do you think the flesh and the spirit go at it in our lives? Just once a day? Twice a day? Or all day? I mean, all day, every day, it's been my experience. If I want to win in the battle, I got to keep the spirit fed. And I got to starve my flesh. And the only way I know to starve my flesh is be careful what I put my mind on. Because if I put my mind on the wrong things, it can get me really weird revelations. I mean, I can come up with some wackos really quick. You know, that person doesn't care about me, and this person doesn't even give a rip, and I'm just all by myself. And And, you know, the flesh only is, well, poor me. But in the spirit, we have a different outlook. Let me show you. Even Peter the Apostle had a bad day of putting his mind on the wrong things. It wasn't in the spirit. And I know it because Jesus called him on it. Okay, now this is a story that it's found in Mark's Gospel and in Matthew's Gospel. But I'm going to start with Mark because some people don't know this. Mark was a young man, John Mark, that traveled. He's believed to be the Mark that traveled with Paul in his missionary journeys. And he got some of his information when he went back to Jerusalem. You know, he was with there in the early church, and that he got his information from Peter. So this Gospel, though it's called the Gospel of Mark, has a lot of the stories that are firsthand, like having Peter, the guy that was there, telling the story to Mark. Mark got most of his information from Peter. So when you read even though this is called the Gospel of Mark, think of this as the Gospel of Mark that Mark heard from Peter the Apostle. Some of the insights will make more sense when you read it, then you'll be like, because how could Mark know that? But if you know Mark got where he got his info, then you realize, oh, he got it from Peter, who was right there. And it's cool because it gives you a perspective, that some of the perspective only Peter would tell. Okay, so this story is found in Mark chapter 8. In verse 27 it reads, then Jesus went out, with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way he questioned his disciples. He said, who do the people say that I am? And they told him, saying, well, some say you're John the Baptist, others say you're Elijah, or one of the prophets. And then Jesus continued questioning them. And he asked, but who do you say that I am? And Peter answered, not one of the other guys, Peter answered, and said, thou art the what? Thou art the Christ. You're the Savior. And so he warned them, he said, don't tell anyone about this. And so he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things, and that he will be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and then he'd be killed. And then after 3 days, he taught them, he was teaching them, look, they're going to reject me. They're going to kill me. But after 3 days, I will rise again. Now he was stating this matter, it says, very plainly to them. This is not mysterious. She's like flat out telling them, they're going to reject me, they're going to kill me, but 3 days later I'm going to rise again. Now do you guys know what Peter said to this? Verse 32, it says, so when he said these things, it says that Peter took him aside and he began to rebuke Jesus. No, Lord, no. But it says, turning around and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. He says, for you are not setting your mind on God's interests, but on whose interests? Man's. What's your mindset on? Is your mindset on the things of God or the things of man? The things of the spirit or the things of the flesh? Why would Peter not want Jesus to die? You guys ever thought of that? I mean, he's been with Jesus for 3 years. He's seen miracles. He's got to cast out demons. He's got to be one of the guys that took the loaves and the fish and go around and break the bread and hand it out. And, you know, they keep breaking and handing it out. And when they're all done, Jesus says, go pick up the leftovers. And there's more leftovers than they started with after they fed over 5,000 men, plus the women, plus the children. I mean, they only counted the men in those stories. So they said 5,000, which, by the way, I don't care if you don't include the women and children. Feed 5,000 men from 12 loaves or 7 loaves, you know, a few small fish. It doesn't matter. It's a miracle. He was, who would volunteer to do that with me? If we had a time teleport machine, say, we're going to go back and help Jesus on that day. Just be one of the bread passer outers. You know? Wouldn't it be cool to tear off the bread, hand it out, and then you look down, and it's back. You know, I mean, it's, you tear off some more, and it just keeps in your hand. It had to be happening right in their hand. I would do it. I mean, that would be so cool. But see, why would Peter say, you don't need to die, Lord. No, don't. No way. Don't. That's terrible. Well, you could say he loved him. Or he loved his free lunch. I mean, for three years, he hasn't had to worry about lunch or dinner or breakfast. It's been covered. Besides that, he's been getting great Bible teaching, constant, you know, instruction for his faith, and he's been walking with Jesus, seeing miracle after miracle. I mean, he's like, but who's he thinking? Jesus said, what was his mind on? On God's interest? No. Because it was on God's interest. God's interest was to come. He sent Jesus. Jesus said, I came to do my Father's command. My Father's commandment was, give them everlasting life. That's the command God gave to Jesus. Go give them everlasting life. But for Jesus to give us everlasting life, what did he have to do? He had to die. He had to come and take the sins of the world on himself and die for our sins. So, for him to do God's bidding, he had to submit to death. And even when he goes later to the garden, he'll pray, Father, if this cup could pass from me, let's let it pass. But nevertheless, not my will, but whose will? Your will be done. And then he goes to the cross and dies for us. Now, he showed us that God's interest was to save man. But Peter's interest was to save Peter. To take care of Peter. To make sure Peter's, you know, comfortable and got a good rabbi, a good teacher, and a good source of food. You know, I'm sure this all factored in to these men's lives. So it says Jesus summoned the crowd and the disciples, and he said, if anyone wishes to come after me, let him deny himself. It says, take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life, it says, will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's, he will save it. It says, for what profit does it profit a man for what does it profit a man to gain the whole world if he forfeits his soul? For it says, for what will a man give in exchange for his soul? For it says, for whoever is ashamed of me, Jesus says, and my words, in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory, the glory of his Father, with the holy angels. So, Peter, he says, listen, this is, and he didn't just tell this to Peter, he got the whole crowd. Everyone, listen up. You want to gain your life? You have to lose it. If you're not willing to lose it, you can't gain it. It's just part of the way Jesus is trying to teach us how to, if we're not willing to let our flesh die, we can't live this new life in the Spirit. So today, Dawn got baptized, and Dylan got to baptize his own mom. That's awesome. That is so cool. So we're going to try to put that in the video today from the little camera that we got, phone camera. We'll see if we can put that in. But that is so cool because when she got baptized, she united herself to Jesus in the likeness of his death. And in the likeness of his what? When we come out of the water, it represents coming up in the likeness of his resurrection. So we can now walk in newness of life. We bury the old nature, the old flesh, and we come up now with a power. By the way, if you've never been baptized, some people don't realize that's the power of overcoming the flesh. Because it's not our power that overcomes the flesh, it's Jesus. So, if I don't join myself, when we baptize people, by the way, we don't baptize them into our church. We baptize them into Christ. Because he's the one that's the power. We join you to him. And Paul said in Romans 6, don't you know that you have been baptized? That you are baptized into Christ? So that you can be, you know, now you can have the power to overcome sin and death. See, before I was baptized, I didn't have power over sin. I didn't. It was like, I didn't wake up and say, hey, I don't want to sin today. I think I'll try to stop. I couldn't even. I just went, how much and how often? You know, when, which ones? It wasn't like, am I not going to sin? It was, I'm going to sin. It's just, which particular sins will I do? But as a Christian that's been baptized into Christ, you now have the power from Christ to say, hey, I died. I buried the flesh. Now I get to walk alive. Now, if my flesh is buried dead, then the black dog has been starved to what? To death. This is, by the way, what we're aiming for. Putting our minds so much on the Spirit and feeding the Spirit of our being all the time, so much that my fleshly motives and things get starved. That they get to the to where they're dead. Like, I mean, face it, if you starve that black dog till he's dead, it doesn't matter. The fight will go on. It's just that the white dog's always going to win. So people want to know, what's the key to victory in my Christian faith? How do I walk in the Spirit like it talks about and win? How do I, you know, really achieve that? I said, you got to starve the black dog. You've got to, and by the way, if Peter the apostle, no, wait, I forgot to show you this. Turn to Matthew. The same sister passage to what we just read about who do men say I am? Jesus is gonna, well, Matthew tells us something that Peter apparently didn't pass on to John Mark. Interestingly enough, let me show you this. This is Matthew chapter 16. It says in Matthew 16, and Jesus asked them, who do men say I am? And some said, verse 14, John the Baptist, others Elijah, some Jeremiah, and one of the prophets. And he said to them, but who do you say that I am? Matthew 16:16, and Simon Peter answered, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said to him, blessed are you, Simon Barjona. Barjona means, bar in Hebrew is son, and Jonah is, so son of Jonah. Someone asked me what that meant. What does Barjona mean? It's just Simon, son of Jonah. He says, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven revealed this to you. And I say also to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not overpower it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And then he warned the disciples that they should tell no one that he was the Christ. Now, you think, oh man, by the way, being raised in the Catholic upbringing, we were taught Peter is the rock that the church is built upon. But I want to show you, if that's the way you interpret this passage, you have a big problem. Because if you just read the next paragraph, you find out something that Jesus says to Peter that would be very disturbing. If I interpret it that way, I'm going to show you the flaw in interpreting it that way, and I'll explain the correct interpretation in just a minute. But in verse 21, because I was brought up with the interpretation that said Peter's the rock that the church is built on. Okay, verse 21. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem, suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and be raised up on which day?
Third day.
But Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, God forbid it, Lord, that this should ever happen to you. Now, Matthew tells us what Peter said. The other passages said Peter rebuked him. I kind of want you to know what Peter said. God forbid. God, and this is like, may it never be. God forbid it. If God forbids it, it's really, you know. And so Jesus, he's telling Jesus, no, Jesus, you don't need to die and be rejected and be an offering for sin. That's a terrible plan. May this never happen to you. And Jesus turned to him and said, get thee behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, he says. For you are not setting your mind on God's interests, but on man's. So, is he saying, get behind me, Satan, Peter, you're Satan? Because he just called him, no. Because that would be really disturbing. He built the church on Peter the rock, who's also Satan. Jesus built the church on... No, that wouldn't work. Because he's calling Jesus right here, get behind me, Satan. I don't think he's saying to Peter, you are Satan.
This idea.
He's this idea that you have. This idea, this revelation is a stumbling block to me. I came to go and die for everyone, and you're trying to get me to not do what I'm called to do. That's a stumbling. Whenever someone tries to talk you out of doing what God wants you to do, They're trying to stumble you. But here's the cause of what made Peter even go down that road. What was his mind set on? Whose interest was he looking out for?
His own.
His own. Whenever you look out for your own interests, you come up with stupid revelations that are not from God. That you open yourself up to getting revelations from the pit of hell. We can do it really easy. I mean, people don't realize. We are so susceptible to coming up with lousy, crummy revelations when we're thinking about our own flesh. They don't care about me. Nobody loves me. Nobody's called me this morning yet. I might as well just, you know, doesn't even matter if I'm on the earth. I've heard people, you know, go into great depression, especially around the holidays, because nobody's called them. And when they call you to tell you this, you go, have you called anyone? No, I was waiting for someone to call me. Well, in the scriptures, John Higgins taught me this verse from Proverbs. To have friends, it says, show yourself to be what? A friend. Friendly. Show yourself to be friendly. You say, I want everyone to be a friend to me. Well, how many people are you being a friend to? Who, you want them to call you and check up on you and see how you're doing? Who have you called to check up on? You know, it's funny how when we're in that mindset of me looking after me, we don't look out after anyone else. And so here, Peter, he was looking after Peter. And Jesus said, yeah, that crummy revelation you have, that I don't need to die. I do need to die, or else I can't save the world. You know, right when he's on the cross, the people heckling Jesus on the cross said, if you're really the Son of God, why don't you come down from that cross and save yourself? He saved others. He can't save himself. Now, could Jesus have just pulled his hands free off the nails, his feet off of the thing, hovered out into the air over the, you know, over the crowd, and said, that's it, I quit. I'm saving myself, fold his arms, and I'm out of here. I mean, he could have. But if he would have saved himself, then he wouldn't have been the offering for our sin, and he couldn't have saved others. So whose revelation do you think came up with that one? You think Satan had any whisperings there to the crowd? Tell him, you saved others. Why don't you save yourself? Why don't you look after your own personal interest? Even Jesus in that moment didn't look after his own personal interest. He looked out for others. And that's what we have to do, right? We have to look out for others. But Peter, he wasn't looking out for others. He was looking out for Peter. And because of it, his mind was getting revelations from Satan himself. And Jesus called him on it. Now see, this shows me how fast I can go from having a really high spiritual moment to a really low, bad, crummy revelation from the pit of hell in just, well, in this case, two paragraphs. How long do you think this was between Peter having this, I could just see Peter. Jesus says, Peter, blessed are you. Flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. I can just see Peter's head going, did you hear that, guys? I had a revelation from God. I'm tied in, man. We were like tight, man. Me and God, we're just, you know. You're the Messiah, Jesus. Yeah, the one sent to save. You're it. And Jesus says, and upon this, he says, this rock will I build my church. What rock? Peter? No, upon the revelation that Christ, Jesus is the Christ. That's the rock. And he says, and the gates of hell will not overpower that. And he gave the keys of the kingdom to Peter. He says, to you guys I give the keys of the kingdom. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. So he gave them this anointing, you know. Guys, you get to serve in the kingdom, you have to be part of this heavenly work. But Peter went from, I just had a revelation from God, to a moment or two later, he's taking Jesus aside saying, God forbid you should die. This is bad, nope, wrong, let's change the plan. So where did he get that revelation, Jesus says? Get behind me what? Satan. Heavenly revelation one minute, satanic revelation the next. Could we do that? Do we ever ping pong from really in the spirit to listening to the wrong voices? I mean, not me. I'd never do that, right? It happened to Peter. Don't feel bad if it happens to you. You're in good company. Even Peter the apostle had a bad, what I call a very bad revelation day. But he had a good revelation before that. Okay, now Jesus tells him that's wrong. And you know, if someone's having a bad revelation, they're like having that mopey, man, I'm not worth anything. No, I don't count in life. You know what I say to them? That's not from the Lord. That is not from God. That is your flesh. You are having a pity party. You are having the poor memes. Knock it off. Because you are so valuable to God, He let His Son die for you. I mean, how much more value do you need? Here's like one of the best mini devotionals I could do for the kids is, how valuable are we to God? Like how does it affect my self-esteem? If I know God loved me so much He gave His Son for me, my self-esteem goes up. Because I realize, I'm loved, man. I'm really loved. Like, with a love where a father would give up his son for me. And we're talking the Father is God the Father, and the Son is the Son of God, and He gave up His life for me. I mean, wow, I guess I must be worth something if the Son of God would. Because it wasn't just me either, it's the whole world. God so loved the world. Which means you're included too if you're sitting there thinking, it doesn't count for me. Yes, you are in the group. You're part of this world, and Jesus died for you too. And so here, this is where we got to learn to put my mind on the Spirit and go, thanks, Lord, that You died for me. Now, if You died for me, Jesus said, if you want to live, lay down your life. If you try to gain your life, you lose it. But if you let your life go for His sake, that's when you gain it. And back to Romans now, he says, this is what we put our mind on. He says, because the mindset on the Spirit in verse 6 is life and peace. This is where we get our life and peace in the Lord. It's when we put our mind on the Spirit. Now it says in verse 9, however, you, it says, are not in the flesh, but you're in the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Him. And if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, yet the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, then He who raised Jesus from the dead will also give life in your mortal body through His Spirit which dwells in you. This solves the problem. Well, wait, I still got my flesh. He says, but do you have the Spirit of the Lord? Because if you're in Christ, guess whose Spirit God gives you? Spirit of Christ comes into you. God's Spirit comes and He's with you. So then it says, brethren, we're not under obligation anymore, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For we are, it says, living now no longer according to the flesh. If we do, we must die. But if we live by the Spirit, we put to death the deeds of the body. And by doing so, we live. In other words, the white dog wins. I mean, I know that I'm using an Indian analogy to explain this, but hey, bear with. It really helps me understand it. If I live by the Spirit, I put to death the deeds of the body. And my black dog, he gets buried. I mean, he loses the fight every time. But let me just tell you, how quick can the black dog be resuscitated in our lives if we feed him? We go, yeah, let's do a little resuscitation here. Give him some water. Give him something to eat. You know, feed the flesh a little bit. It's funny how quick we can start feeding our flesh, and then wondering why is my spiritual life in the potty? You know, why is it going down so quickly? Because we fed the wrong thing. We didn't keep our mind on the things of the Spirit. So you do get a choice. I want to encourage you. This is the next part of the chapter goes on to talk about how we are adopted as God's children. And by the way, for people who, you might have friends that they were, maybe they're orphaned or they didn't have a good family home life, they didn't feel connected in their family. This is one of the greatest comforts. The next part of the chapter of Romans 8 just speaks to our hearts about how God has brought us into His family. And He lets us be in a family that is never going to betray us, never going to let us, you know, fall. And it just, I don't know, it is so good. Because had the best family life growing up. And some people that don't, we get great comfort from this next part of the past. So I'll say that for, it won't be next Sunday because we're going to be doing Christmas service. But the following Sunday after that, starting off the new year, will be about the comfort that we get. We get to start the new year with the comfort that comes from knowing we're part of God's family. And that'll be a cool way to start off the new year. But for today, I just want to encourage you to keep feeding the white dog. Keep feeding your spirit. Keep putting your mind on things of the spirit. And you know, some people say, well, what does that entail? I said, I think pretty much it's self-explanatory. I mean, if you need instruction, ask one of your Christian, you know, friends or family members that have been in Christ a while, because they'll be able to give you some pointers that are, you know, like maybe things that they do. I know for me, I'm really affected by what music I listen to. If I put on music that feeds my spirit, I'm good. I put on music that's not things of the spirit, you know, like just carnal lyrics and stuff. It drags me down really fast. And I can get really, cranky or I don't know what the right word. I'm trying to pick my words carefully here. What? It affects me, man. I listen to crummy music and it makes me in the mood to fight. And I came from a background of fighting, and so, like, I don't need much fuel on that fire to make that part come out. And so I recognized that a long time ago. And in fact, from my own life, I just try not to listen to secular music at all, so that the lyrics and stuff don't get. I'm not knocking them. A lot of the music's really well played. My dad was an orchestra leader, had his own orchestra. So I had to learn to play all styles of music growing up, and I can appreciate the quality of the music, the skill level of some of the musicians is just awesome. But if I listen to the lyrics, some of them just feed my flesh too much and too quickly. And all of a sudden, I have a new battle on my hand. My flesh is going, let's go back in the ring, you know? I'm going to whoop on your spirit, and then I'm walking after the flesh after just a couple songs. Sometimes even just a pass through the grocery store, and you come out and you don't even realize the song is running through. Have you ever had that happen where you didn't even, like, why am I singing this old, moldy, oldie song that, you know, and you're like, that thing, and it's because it was playing at KTA or something, and you heard it, and you didn't even realize you heard it until you're in your car and the lyrics kept coming back through your head playing. It's like Row, Row, Row Your Boat. I hate that song. Who wrote that? You know, you hear it once and all of a sudden it's stuck in your head all day. Why do they do songs like that, you know? It's just mean, you know, it's just torture. So I know for myself, feeding my spirit, one of the pointers I can give you is put on praise music. Praise music does something to keep my spirit always hearing what it needs to hear. And if it gives a little bit of food to my spirit, and it starves my flesh. My flesh hates it, you know. By the way, when I was a new Christian, I didn't like praise music. Because I was so in the flesh that hearing praise music was like, oh, I can't take this, man. It's like too spiritual or something, you know. And it took me a while to feed my spirit and develop an appetite for spiritual things. My white dog was so starved. When you're really starved, do you guys know this? If you fast for a really long time, can you then go to a buffet and do an all-you-can-eat buffet after you've fasted, say, for 3 weeks? What will happen? You'll get sick, man. You will be hurt. You'll be puking. So what do you have to do to break the fast? You have to just a little nibble, a little bit of water, right? A little soft food to get it going, get the system back. It's the same with your spirit. If you've never spent time feeding your spirit, it might take a little bit of just a little taste, a little bit, listen to some devotional. But as you grow in the Lord, you'll find that, like for me, I can't go wrong with, I can have praise music on all the time. Just always playing in the background. It's the best thing I know to keep me in the spirit. Just as a, for my spirit, just good to always have it playing in the background, have it, just like speaking to my spirit, just the lyrics. And even if the musicianship isn't what I care for, I still try to appreciate the words feeding my soul what it needs. because I know that my soul needs it. And my black dog is always waiting for a scrap to fall from the table. Anything to feed it. Any little thing that the devil can slip in to feed my flesh, he tries to nail me with. And he's always trying. He's like, he's a rascal. He's always trying to slip a little food to my black dog, you know, whenever he can to feed that. And I got to be really conscious to say, no, that dog is dead. I'm not feeding that dog. I'm here to feed my spirit. So this is a truth. I don't know if it helps you, but this part of Romans helps me to just like know what to do. Like, I'm not condemned because I have sinned, but I am given an option of how to not have to keep walking it. I can be freed. And Dawn got freed today when she got baptized. She buried her old man, and now she gets to walk a new life, what Paul says, after the Spirit. So, Romans 6, 4, and 5, she just got to experience this morning, and I'm just excited for her. That's so awesome. And then we get to for you guys tonight, I want to, today, after this, if you have a few minutes, Mary shared with the youth group pictures from Thailand. We opened up her Facebook page and played her videos and stuff, and it's so much better when she's here than when we, because I've been looking at them, but I don't know the name, you know, like, she knows who that is and who's that and what they're doing, you know, and stuff, and it just made it come alive, you know, to see the kids. So if you'd like to see the kids that we support with our bottles and cans that we recycle for the orphanage. Alfred, God bless him, goes to the recycle place. Last time he went four truckloads, right? It's a four truckload, $220+ we got. For now, $220+ in Thai money, guys. One of our dollars is 30 of theirs. So it's a lot, you know. It's you get to multiply that by so it was like giving them $6,000 plus of money. So for us, it was just like, I mean, that's a big victory, because it's 200 times 30, 6,000. It's 220, actually. It's more than 6,000 of their dollars. So it was awesome. It was just like the amount of buying power. Now, Mary, I don't want to steal her thunder, because she'll tell you about how when she took out like 15 people to lunch. Was it? No, 24 people to lunch. 24 people to lunch, the all-you-can-eat buffet. Guess how much it cost her in U.S. dollars? To feed, I mean, a fancy hotel buffet, like what we pay $30 to $50 a head. And what did it cost you to feed all those guys?
$3,000.
So $100. So for $100, she fed 24 people at a fancy hotel, what we would go for $30 to $50 a head here. Just for one of us, she fed 24, the whole staff of the orphanage, for all you can eat buffet at a fancy. That's the fancy. Now for their regular lunch, you know, we only had 15 of us and we went out for regular lunch, and it was like what, $12 or something you spent to feed the whole. She told us the amount in baht and I converted, but. It was really a real deal breaker, you know. I'm just like, oh man, no wonder people go to Thailand. The food is good and cheap, you know. So I'm gonna let her share a little bit after we close in prayer, of just the like highlights. And you guys can ask her how it was, you know, this being, because she went for 3 months. Remember, she was gonna just go help teach English as a second language for 3 months at the orphanage, and she stayed 4 years to the day. So she's been. You know, many a time when we have our youth group here, we have the devices. I'll have my phone, you know, with her on FaceTime sitting next to me. And then we'll have, like, some of the other kids that are on the mainland around me. And we do the youth group, and we have them. It's funny because Joy will be talking, and I'll go, Joy, hi, say hi to Mary. And I'll hold the two devices together. They'll be talking, you know, blah, 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 blah. The only, in this generation, could you take someone that's in Thailand, someone that's in North Carolina, and have them meet in Hawaii in the pastor's house, talking. I mean, it's hilarious to listen to them hold the two devices together going, this is a weird generation, you know, but it's cool. So she's been hearing us and being listening and talking with the kids all along those 4 years that come to the youth group here. But now I get to have her live with the picture. So I'm going to let her have a few minutes, you guys. I think like five, 10 minutes, if you don't mind, just to hear. And you can pick her brain. I'm going to have all the kids scooch over here. So let's pray. Lord, thanks for this time in your word. Just help us to use the things we learned today from Romans, Lord, just to be able to feed our spirit and to overcome our flesh, Lord, that we could have a mindset on the things of the Spirit as you desire for us. I just pray that for each person here in Jesus' name. Everyone that agreed with me said?
Amen.
Amen.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.